Why don't you call it to order then?
Yes, do you have the time, Ron?
The time is 7:07.
We'll call the meeting to order at 7:07.
Second.
We can't.
No, we don't need to. We're gonna start anyway. We have a quorum. Francine wasn't able to attend. She's in Salt Lake doing some genealogy research. And she should be stopping some of the traveling around May. So she's been busy, a very busy person for a while now, doing a lot of traveling, a lot of research. But she did give me an update, which I can go through in a little bit. But first I wanted to make a couple of announcements. And one is that we got the invitation to do Freedom's Way Hidden Treasures again this year. We did that last year. And we featured the Pebble Covered Bridge, working with the Lawrence Library. And it was well attended. We were very pleased with the results. We've been approached again to do Hidden Treasures for this year. And I just wanted to point out that this year, we're one of the treasures that's featured on Freedom Way's postcard that everybody gets. There's the covered bridge, which is really exciting. So I talked, emailed Deb Spratt, and I know that she's already sent out some inquiries on what we could cover as one of the hidden treasures this year. And the conservation trails and our wonderful conservation land is one of the things that's being discussed right now, so we should hear pretty soon. I also wanted to just mention that the Historical Commission's annual report is due to the town, along with all the other annual reports, by February 6th.
I've got to get to work on that, I
will
promise
you. Will you be able to do
I'll
that,
get you a draft
Ron?
On that.
Oh, I'll work with you on that, too, and
well,
just fill
what
in.
I'll do is I'll give you a draft, and then you can take it from there. And what I basically do is I just cut and paste from all of the minutes, put those together, and then distill them into a document. It's not that much work, but I got to remember to do that. I promised you I would do that.
And we'll send it out for review, and we can all comment and add anything that we might
miss. I'll try to get it this week, so we'll have time to make the deadline.
Sure.
And
send it in to Peggy Mazzola, she rolls it up with everything. But we'll work together on that, so probably see that in about a week or so. Next order of business is the minutes from the last meeting, unless somebody has them.
Did everybody get them? I emailed them very late this afternoon. Okay, so you didn't get a chance. But anyway, here is the
keep them all the
printed form of this here.
Thank you.
I'm really sorry I got them this late. Usually I try to get them a few days in advance, but this was...
Well, we've had a couple of back-to-back meetings, too, so...
Well, it kind of fell way behind and stuff, but... the big thing was the discussion and the vote on the press to continue forward with the Prescott statue plan.
Yes, we did.
And, with that,
have a motion that passed successfully at our last meeting to be involved in raising funds for a statue in town to honor Colonel Prescott.
And establish an account also.
And to approach the town to establish an account,
for
a gift account,
that.
And I've got some information to report on that.
Okay.
And we can cover that shortly, but we did make the vote, and so that's in the minutes of the last meeting.
Date.
Were there any questions, any discussion about the minutes of the meeting?
No.
I'd like to make one change.
Yes, please.
There is one town I did not hear back from, and that's Sandwich. And
You
recall at the last meeting, I had called several different towns in Massachusetts, talked with the historical commissions there. Just to understand
well, do you
want to
add
the
any, fundraising. Do you want to add any others besides it? You went Ware, Beckett, and Stoneham you mentioned, but if there are any others.
Ware, Beckett, and Stoneham I did hear from, did confirm that they get involved in fundraising, some of the projects that they do, but I didn't hear back from Sandwich.
Okay.
So I had gathered information off their website that seems to indicate that they do some level of fundraising, and I couldn't really confirm they didn't call me back. So I think that it shouldn't be in the minutes.
We'll strike that out.
That we can confirm that they do. But
we'll just make it Ware, Beckett, and Stoneham, and still towns but larger and smaller in Pepperell.
Yep.
Ware and Beckett, I think, are smaller, and Stoneham's definitely larger.
Definitely larger. And that was really what we wanted to show.
Yeah.
Was we were sort of right in the middle of
and
the
it's
population.
A good geographic, to the east and to the west of us, too. So.
So if we could just eliminate Sandwich until I have some more information
so
back from
them.
So as
modified. Now, I'll send you out a new one from this. So I'll just strike that. So All right.
So I'd like to motion that we accept the minutes to the last meeting as amended with that correction.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So moved. And our first order of business was to really go into a donations review, but Francine wasn't able to attend. So we really can't go over the earlier donations that we did about two meetings ago, which are being reviewed, and I think there's some scanning of some of the images and postcards and things. But you recall, they were some of the meeting notes to the early women's temperance group in Pepperell.
That's right.
And we also got lots of postcards, some that we didn't have, and mm-hmm. we want to take a look at what we've got, what needs to go to the library,
and
what
account
should go
books,
to the society.
And those account books.
And the accountants, yeah, the accounting books.
Sure.
So those are out being reviewed, so we'll review those as soon as review them as soon as we have Francine back.
Okay.
Right. But we do have some more things from the same donor.
Oh.
And where we have a quorum, we can take a look at these. These are a little more straightforward, and we probably will be able to decide where these should go. But,
do you want to do those now?
Yeah.
Yeah,
just take a look at a couple
all
of
right.
them. This is, and I think we already talked about, you know, we talked online.
That's a reproduction, though, isn't it?
Reproduction of them.
Yeah.
The library may or may not have it. Mm-hmm. Might make sense to approach them first to be mm-hmm. sure that they have
yeah.
a nice, clean
yeah.
copy. And something like this is good.
Love to get an original. Original would mm-hmm. be very nice to have. I don't think there's one in town that I know of, right? Does anybody know an original?
No. Do we have this at Town Hall? That would be my other question.
I've never seen it. I've never seen the original. The 1870 plus one, 73 one, I've got a copy of that at home. I mean, that's a county atlas in which there are a lot of copies floating around. But this one is
okay.
a rare bird.
How are you looking at that? There's more maps. And which one is this one? Common and
oh yeah, this is what's in the Pepperell Reader. That's just the master of the.
And that this was another one. Some of that.
Yeah, these are redrawings of the map in Town Hall.
Caleb Butler.
Yeah, the
early
Caleb
ones,
Butler.
But all copies. No
yeah, these
originals.
Are copies.
Right,
right. Well, the original is on the yeah. wall there. That's they've got the original. It's handwritten by Joseph Butler, Caleb Butler.
In the Town Hall.
Yeah, the one upstairs.
Oh, okay.
You ever looked at that? That's amazing.
Not
map.
Close enough, obviously.
Yeah, and the switch. Illustrations, these are good, but the person that did them didn't quite have the
skill.
Yeah, the copier, I mean, did the best, but you, if you look at the originals, they have more detail on them, and I've taken pictures of some of the originals on there.
Does that one differ? Oh, I believe these are the same.
Yeah.
We have a note from the owner. Print is the 8th. Out of 200 printed, so it was limited edition.
Yeah, no, we want to. We want to save those. I mean, I wouldn't throw those out or anything.
Well, yeah, but
we don't have to keep them in a frame necessarily.
I mean, if the library has them, if the library doesn't, these could still go to the historical society.
Yeah.
At some point, once we begin to duplicate things, the society has the ability to do some fundraising for some of their projects with these things.
Right, and eventually, someday, a town museum would be nice, run by the society.
Yeah.
I mean, that would be a very nice thing to have. A lot of towns, of course, do. But
so this one here is worth checking to see whether the library has it, whether it's also a town hall, because keeping these things in the town hall for the public to see is.
Oh, they're nice to have just when somebody's talking about a particular piece of property, you can look on the map and you can see references to it. And big thing is reference to houses that don't exist anymore. They're only cellar holes now. They show up on here and, you know, sometimes even by the 1873 map, they're not there anymore. And,
back with the early map making, they would draw the house very similar to the actual.
Well, that's just it. They are. They are little
so
pictures of the house. And I say, if you look at the one upstairs, if you look at those, they're really detailed little pictures.
I have
of
to look closely.
He went around painting a little picture of each house, and it's fascinating because you can tell certain houses either been drastically changed or just completely replaced. They're not the same house. Like for example, the one that's on my house, which is the Joseph Green, John Green house. You see up there?
Right there.
Yeah, it doesn't look anything like my house, and that's because it burned, in 1850,
yes.
But I found that out later. And I'm sure there's others the same way on there. And also some have been moved, and this may show the original location of the house. And then you figure, hey, that's my house, but it's not, it's across the street. Yeah, because they moved it across the street. They seem to do a lot in those days. That would be another interesting project if you ever wanted to do is a list of all the houses that we know have been moved, buildings that we know have been moved in town. And it would be, you know, probably a couple dozen at least.
Good idea.
But yeah, those, that's in the Peveril Reader, they have that.
This one here is 1844, I know.
What else do you got, anything else?
Well, these ones are pretty simple. This was,
As we'll go through them, right. Oh, yeah, these are the books that
we got a number of nice condition antique children's books.
Yeah.
And while I understand, you know, the early children's books fairly well, it's hard to tell when you have a first edition, and those tend to be the most valuable. But these are undoubtedly in excellent condition for a children's book, even though you're seeing some damage here.
Because they
children's
obviously
books,
got,
they don't
got,
survive.
That's
yeah,
right.
They're well played with. There's about a half a dozen of them. One other partial book that was molded that really isn't of value, but this, six of these are.
But see, the question is, of course, is it have anything to do with Peveril? I mean, the fact that people in Peveril had that, but that you could take almost any antique and say that people in Peveril used candlesticks and they used, you know, whatever, chairs and you know, mirrors and things like that. And they
so
did.
This is what a child around 1895, the kind of book that they would have used in the early illustrations. And this is signed by, it's from Mr. Blackwood to Florence Bartlett. And December 25th on Christmas of 1895.
Of course.
So, why else would you? Rather nice
and
gift.
I'm sure
right?
it was a very much appreciated gift under the tree.
So, what do you think for, you know, where we should target these?
That's a very good question.
In the library, wouldn't it be nice for the kids to see what early children's books looked like, although handling them, you know, needs to be supervised. But I don't know if they would display, and they're such good examples. And then, of course,
well, that's the other
society
option. We can retain just for that purpose. I mean, we can retain them for educational or for display use or something like that. And again, if we ever got to the point of a town museum, something like that could be used in display with, you know, what was a child's life like in the 1890s or something like that. Sure.
Well, could, I think the children would that. Might find it interesting, the language, say, how people spoke, and it actually can be a little confusing what they're actually trying to say.
Sure.
But
well, there's music
and
in there too, huh?
And, this should probably have songs.
Oh yeah, there's some
poems.
Music there. Yeah.
Shep the errand dog, you know, and the types of
all
images,
that stuff.
The clothing that they wore, little boys dressed like little girls.
That's
almost,
right.
You know,
no, they did. Yeah. They did. You see pictures and you see, oh, it's a daughter, and you find out, no, that was their son.
Yeah.
It throws people off sometimes.
So it would be nice to share with the young people, but I think that the public in general would enjoy looking at these, and these are perfect examples to look at. But then, you know, you also got the Historical Society that's doing the district schoolhouse.
Well, again, if the schoolhouse were used, if you at least put up a
display, nice
display
there.
It's right from that period. What's the date of that inscription?
1895.
Whoa, that's about the year they think they closed the schoolhouse, wasn't it? Like 1895,
so
something like
time
that, right around that time.
And there will be some things on display there, whether or not these are,
I mean,
math books and things like that. History books are definitely appropriate, but this might also be appropriate.
Yes, yeah, sure.
So,
anything related
anybody
want to
make a suggestion on where we start? I would say the library would be.
You could start with the library, sure.
Yeah.
Probably dedicate a section to old books that handle with care.
No, that's whether they. I don't know whether they have anything like that. I'm hoping to get around to volunteering at the library if I can ever get under all this.
With all the other things that you do. Well.
Got less
I'll
time
do that, and I'll email everybody
time.
And let you know what I find out.
There's some truth to that. That some days I put a full 8-hour day. The difference is I don't drive back and forth to work, and maybe different things, but they're not. They're things that are actually work. They're projects that you're actually doing work for somebody or for something.
I'll flip that over. These are old stereoscopics. Some of them are from the area. Most of them are sort of random, generic.
Yeah, that's what we talked
images.
About. That, the same problem.
A little of some of these, but the library does have a very nice collection of some of these already, and there are a few that are purple. And some that, well, they're probably Southern Hampshire or the vicinity, but they definitely are representative of what this rural area, mm-hmm. you know, and the farmland, and what it would have all been like back in the day. But they're not specific to Pepperell, but, I mean, they're just wonderful
nice,
images.
Yeah.
I did a little repair on this one. It was in really bad shape, but it's now, it's actually usable. Very, very minor repair. Just bring it back to life.
Mm-hmm.
So,
they use the
stereo.
Yeah.
Anybody wants to take
that's
a look
what
at
they
it? I could take those to the library and start there. I think that's.
Oh yeah, sure.
Probably.
Always. I can see if there's.
Oh well, we also have some postcards here too.
Townsend Center.
Does it say that?
I think so.
Yeah,
there's
railroad
station, Townsend Center.
We're in the area.
It's on Railroad Street. That station's still there. So.
Okay.
Oh, yes, that's right.
This is Keene.
Oh. Right, so we're nearby. Maybe not all in Pepperell or the surrounding towns.
That's a School Street Catholic Church. Doesn't say where though.
Oldest house in
right.
the United States. Along the Spanish somewhere.
And then if you
St.
flip
Augustine,
it over,
Florida.
You get all the background
oh, yeah.
on this oldest house.
That's what it said there, yeah.
The bakery.
Littleton, New Hampshire.
They probably even have a viewer at the library. They're not too difficult to come by.
Jim and Jack plowing.
Yeah. Common as advertising. Sort of your business card, so to speak. Then there are a couple of dozen postcards, most of which we already have. There might be a couple in here that are in a little bit better condition than others. But the library, again, has an extensive postcard collection,
yeah.
Without which we wouldn't have been able to post the historic images on the Pepperell website. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
Definitely. Want to continue to add those.
Well, it's all stereo. There's the stereo.
Yeah.
Stereo.
My favorite.
Features, so.
Isn't that just downtown Pepperell?
Fabulous.
A couple different library ones. Here are two that are photo postcards that would be really good for our historic images project because this one seems to depict maybe a business. And here's the church and just before.
Yeah, it's maybe a business, but where?
Just looking at it, other than the businesses, really
one.
Not much has changed. You
right,
know,
right. If you
look at
still
the building,
that facade, that
yeah.
look. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is you don't even know if this is in Pepperell.
That one, not clear.
Yeah.
Doesn't say on the back of it.
No, it doesn't.
And these were given to this person after. From a close friend of the family.
Right.
So she can't really validate you know, what we have here. But this is definitely Pepperell. And this is before Hutchinson's went in.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the church.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, that's,
so that's a great
that's
great
Hutchinson.
And that's Main Street Pepperell. So.
That is Hutchinson's store. That's original Hutchinson's store. And then he tore it down and put up the prison building on that
even
side.
Without, that's...
Yeah,
it when it was open?
Yeah, it was originally a store. And it was his general
no
store.
No signs on
the. Well, the sign is probably
on the
other
gable side.
Of it. Yeah, yeah,
okay.
It's probably on that
and
side.
And that's a side door or something.
Yeah. I mean, it was originally once a house, but my understanding was, by the time this postcard was made, like the 1890s, that was already Hutchinson was keeping the store
there. Car.
And they built the Presbyterian Parish House. He built that around 1910, thereabouts. But it was to replace this thing. That's why there's like, see that there's a flag out there?
Mm-hmm.
A little with, like a, yeah. But it wasn't. It was a general
okay,
store.
So
he had a general store.
When the store was actually open.
Yeah.
So this is really appropriate. So
No, these are definitely ones you want to keep. I mean, those are. Oh, yes. Nashua River
probably.
Division. St. Regis Paper Council.
Let's just see what we should scan really quick. You have some Groton ones here. And here's early postcards before they started colorizing.
Mm-hmm.
and the linen card. So this is really early covered bridge.
Yeah.
This is very early.
Colored by Hutchinson.
Covered bridge.
So you say, yeah.
It's a nice one.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is a really good colorized.
And that's a used one too,
bridge.
Which is I always find that the used ones fascinating.
So we really can't use that.
Hutchinson.
Yeah.
Is this the first one?
Scan.
It'll be the first bridge, right?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Oh, it lasted to what, 1964 or something like that. So.
They made them to last. Of course, yeah, I have automobiles going over them and trucks. Yeah. And
this is a solid back, so this is a really
October 28th, but I can't read the year. Can you read the year?
Yeah, very hard. I can't see it now either.
It's whenever a penny was a postcard. So.
No. Corey might be able to.
What are you trying to say?
You've got the eyes of youth.
Yes, I have my magnifying glass.
October 28th.
I can read that part.
The bottom.
Yeah, it's the date.
The Willows, I understand this is a hard postcard to get.
Oh, I have one.
You do?
Yeah, I found that a place in Maine.
Yeah. Good for you.
I have a very small postcard. I only have about a dozen cards. Cards and other things.
How about these two to scan? They seem to be the most appropriate to put in the historic pepperlands.
Oh, sure.
And then...
That's headed the bridge.
Looking up the bridge.
That's McNabb's,
that
the bridge right there.
That house is still there.
You could actually...
I didn't change that much.
Basically.
Yeah, that's right.
Would you be able to scan those? You think we should scan them like we did last time? Because the quality came out so good.
Right. Sure. Scan them if you want.
And then we'll send them off to...
Well, the postcards have limits. I mean, you can basically, although this one may not be a postcard, it may actually be an actual print. It's whether they're engraved or whether they're actually photos. They did both. I mean, they would do some that would look
right.
Colorized.
And so we're limited on how the public could enlarge these or a business could enlarge them and use them when they're postcards because you get that granular.
Depends what
the resolutions isn't so great, but... Still, they when I enlarged them, I was still able to get 12, 14-inch wide images, and they came out with good resolution. So before we hand them off, it would be good to scan them. And then we'll get them off to Martin Kadick and put them on the town website. Let me make sure we've got all of these.
When did Kemp go into business? Almost.
I don't know.
Almost.
Time ago.
I want to say that when I moved to town in the early 70s, this was called Jenny's. The Jenny Station. I don't know about
Kemp.
Yeah. And it's certainly the same location as Kemp's.
Yeah.
Although, the railroad building is still there. Yeah. This would be.
40s.
Yeah. Or maybe around 1950, because you get cars like this is, I think that's like about a post-war. Some of these, the longer, more streamlined things are post-war.
Yeah, and this one here, too.
Post-war.
Looks a little newer.
This one here. Yeah, that looks
50-ish.
I think this is probably about 52, 53, because of that car there.
Mm-hmm.
I think that looks like about a 52 or a 53. I do not know much about cars except from the 50s. Cars from when I was a kid, up to the 50s and 60s, I can usually identify and give you a pretty good guess on what it is, earlier and later now. My brother-in-law, though, could tell you all these and give you within a year or two all of those. I mean, just from this much, he could say, that's a 39 Nash, that's a 41 Plymouth, that's a 50, a 49 Ford. He can do all these. He's good at that. I can only do that with like a 65 Mustang. I can show you. Yeah.
Well, better than me.
I can't do anything else.
The other thing this shows you is how long ago. We've still had this angle parking on our main street.
Oh, well, yeah.
This has been...
That goes back to
goes way back.
Goes back to the 20s, probably.
That they've angle parked.
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Well, there wasn't much parking regulation then, so that developed.
Which is, has been...
Well, that's the big
giving us more parking space and something that would be advantageous to.
Well, years ago, you know, the state was going to throw a lot of money at Railroad Square, and they had an advisory committee, and supposedly that became the issue. The state said you can't have angle parking, and they said, "The hell with that, we'll be out of business." And they so they said, "You can take your money," and the state said, "Fine, we will not force money on anybody. We'll be glad to take our money somewhere else." And they did. They just, so we never got the money. Never got the improvements.
It'd be important to show just how long this has been going on in our town.
Oh, you can put together quite a set of Railroad Square photos. The trick would be trying to organize them chronologically. That would be a challenge.
Right.
Sit down with like two dozen of them and try to come up with the exact, this building is here, this building isn't there, so this must be after that one.
Right, and when this one burned, and then that was three levels, and now it's two levels, but then there was this other fire, and it affected that. And then they added that, and they used part of the building, but they altered it. And if you look at them, sometimes you see some subtle architectural.
There's a couple of dozen, you know, pictures in existence of Railroad Square over the years, maybe more, maybe like 30 of them or so.
Tell me about this one, Pepperell House.
Yeah, that's, okay.
What's the age of that?
Trying to get the orientation of this thing. This is, what is this? It's pre-fire, that's why it is. But where, what street are we on? What are we looking at? This is where Sue Smith is really good.
I'm stumped.
Sue can look at this and she can tell you what street this is on.
What's the name of the house?
Well, it says Pepperell House.
Is that on the map?
I don't think so.
You might be able.
The 1903, there's this big fire. It takes out a lot of downtown, and it may be some of that. But I don't recognize the orientation of that exactly, those buildings.
I haven't seen it.
Because they're multi-level things. It looks, at first it's tempting, it kind of looks like the Prescott House, but that's not the way the Prescott House is, unless, what do you think? Yeah, it looks like the Prescott House.
You
would have had to have
is the Prescott here?
Yeah. See, here's the Prescott, That's the Prescott.
Well, yeah. So I remember when that burned.
And this is
through the windows.
Yeah, this is pretty easy because this is basically going down to the railroad tracks here, and this is the, I mean, there's a building still in the same orientation. You're going up Groton Street here, and then that's Tarbell up in the
corner. We're going to be across from the Prescott.
But I don't know where that is. It's the multi-level things. It's the fact that these are buildings that are up in the high, but they've got an open. So what are we talking about?
I was thinking at first that Main Street, Railroad Square is here.
Yeah.
And this would be like one hotel place, but I don't think so now.
I remember a lot of the things did burn there, that fire, so.
Yeah, but.
I know. And there's no railroad. If I could see a railroad,
there was a railroad somewhere. Yeah, you could nail it, but there's no houses here, and there's old houses all here.
Yeah.
That one, when this would have been.
Because that's probably from 1890s, maybe, something like that. Not much earlier than that. There's no wires, though, are there present?
No, yeah, there's a telephone pole.
Oh, there's a telephone pole.
Right here.
Okay. So
I think that's a pole, or a flag pole.
Probably the 90s.
So can we scan that? And then once I have the image, I'll send it out for an inquiry with Sue. See what
it says, Prescott.
Well, if you want to loan me anything that you want me to scan, I can scan.
Yeah,
I have good scanners. And
I think these six here
can do a decent job.
The ones you did before were excellent. Yeah. These look like they don't really need too much Photoshop or anything.
Well,
if you put a little behind it to block it, that's nothing. Right? It doesn't interfere with the image at all.
The new Prescott.
And then get them off for my time or something. But I'll ask Susan about that. Really curious.
Well, you know what this is? This is a copy of a postcard. And it's been reduced a little bit in size, you see?
Photo.
Yes,
sure.
See, that was originally, I've never seen the original of this postcard. That is really interesting. Have you ever seen the original of this?
No, I'm totally stumped.
I didn't see that one. Wow.
So, since I haven't seen the postcard either. We may not have it in the archives of the postcards that we have on the town website either. So
it's absolutely fascinating.
Makes sense
it's
to
going, it's going up at that point.
Wow. Make sure that we have a copy of that so we can get in the room.
Well, I would say it's got to be close to the river if it's going up a hill like that.
Yeah,
right?
It's going up a hill, and up at the top of the building, it's up there, and then the bottom is the back is of those buildings is there. So it's, and as you said, it's all open up here.
Yeah.
So
first thing that came to my mind was the building next to Cumberland Farms there, where Patriot haircut place.
Yeah.
And then that'd be what, Canal Street? But I doubt it.
But everything is, yeah. It's just the orientation of the road going up like that. I don't quite, and it's long enough that it's, and this big wide area here, I mean, it's an open for something. Not a house or a building or anything like
Is that? See how open we're here?
Yeah.
That's why I'm thinking it's across the street from that, but where are the houses that should be here?
Yeah, that's what gets me.
Any tree growth there?
The thing is, if it were the other side of this, then the railroad should be right about here. And you know, this doesn't make, and then all these buildings would have to go, because I've never seen any of these buildings, I don't think any of us have, so they're all gone. And so you think of the fire, I mean, other than that, otherwise why would they tear down so many buildings in a row? You don't do that.
Google the Pepperell House.
The Pepperell House.
Yeah. East Pepperell, saw that in that vicinity.
All right, well, as I said, if you want, I will take these.
Absolutely, thank you, Ron.
I'd be happy to do that. Give me something. Give me something new to keep out of trouble.
I think you have a lot to do.
I seem to have a lot to do. No.
I got no signal in this bomb shelter.
This week's a whole year since I retired. So.
You've already been retired.
One year.
This
week.
Time goes by.
It does.
Wow.
Well, I hope you're enjoying it.
Oh, by far. Particularly on days like this, I don't have to drive. I don't have to drive to work. And, oh yeah, we're going to do a lot of stuff, a lot more. So no, I don't have any.
Well, next on the agenda is the Colonel Prescott statue discussion. Quick update. I had sent out some emails, so just to reiterate some of what I've already sent to people about progress we've made is, I did talk with the Historical Society about our, you know, desire to raise funds for the statue and maybe some other preservation or educational things in the future. And they felt that it really added a great deal of continuity and credibility when the Historical Commission is involved in fundraising activities. They are happy to partner with us, and we always seem to work, you know, together on a lot of projects anyways, but they may not be able to take on any new large-scale projects or anything right now. And there may be the possibility of running some funds through the organization, and we could talk to them about that, and perhaps that may be when we go on more of a public scale on some fundraising things, if we are allowed to do so, so we can still go back and approach the Historical Society about partnering on some of that, and but they thought it was a good idea to have us out talking to the public, because you know we're the longevity of the commission in town, being involved in town. I sent out the Mass Department of Revenue certificate of exemption that the town uses, and it is the same number that I used when I was on the Covered Bridge Committee, and we did some fundraising for the grand opening in the Prudence Wright Overlook, and that number is still valid. And anyone who wanted to make a donation, again, if we are given the approval to raise funds, that they can use that to on their taxes, write off any donations that they make. So the other thing that I did was I talked with the town accountant, and we talked about how we would keep money separate if we were able to do this in a gift account. And in order to do that, we'd have to have more than one fund if we were going to raise money for different purposes. So since it's a long-term plan to, because it's such a large amount that we would need for a statue, that should probably be in a separate fund. But if we had other educational type of projects that we were working on, we would have to open up another gift account. And it would be tracked separately, and we would come to our meetings, and we would report on the funds, what revenue we had, and any expenses that were made to various funds. But they would come into separate funds, and we'd track them separate. And the purpose would be defined separately as well. We've talked about maybe having historical markers and needing that in town, and other type of historical, sharing historical information, whether it was kiosks or signage. Historical markers is, you know, one of the things that we had a lot of discussion on at previous meetings, but and we don't have any money to be able to do those types of projects, but in the future we may have a separate fund that would be dedicated
possibly
to that.
Possibly a publication or, you know, or we would print a flyer up or something like that, sure.
Mm-hmm. And so those funds would be tracked separately. We could get a report on a monthly basis. Anyone who made a donation would have to say exactly what it was for. It was for a statue, or if we had another project, exactly what the donation was, what the intent of the donation was. So the next step really is to meet with Mark Andrews, and Corey and I have that scheduled for
February 6th, 4 p.m.
And we're going to, you know, share with him what we've found since the last meeting that we had when we started the discussion, which would include the Mass Legislation, Chapter 40, Section 8D, specifically, that says that the Historical Commission can accept gifts, and it defines what they are. And I did some further research there, because there, when you start to look at all that legal terminology, it starts to point to, you can do it, but you have to do it according to this legislation, and according to...
Sure.
So I began to pull all the different types of legislation to show a pattern, so that we really know exactly what we should do and how we should do it. For example, when donations come in, they need to clearly say who they came from. We need to be tracking the amount, the date, the name of the donor. So those, and once we do those things and we keep things transparent, and then we're following the law, basically. So we want to present that to Mark and see if we can get town council in, you know, in the town to support our efforts to do this. So that meeting is set, and I think we have put together what we need for that meeting. Does anyone have any other suggestions? Is there anything that we're missing? Are we weak with any information? We've got some background of other towns that have done it. Some similar reasons. If you looking at some of the other towns as case studies, they've got a lot of success in raising funds. They were able to apply for matching grants, because prior to that, the historical commissions didn't have any money, so they couldn't get all this, you know, state grant money, because they didn't have the 50-50 matching portions that they needed.
Right.
And now they're able to do that, and they've been applying for grants and successfully getting money for a lot of preservation. When I talked to Mark, he also mentioned that there was some preservation in the town hall that would be good to look at in the future. There's pipes that recently broke and caused some problems, and there are some other things in town hall that have a preservation scope that we may be able to help with if we had some funds, and certainly if we could get matching funds from the state or other sources. So that's kind of our message in a nutshell, and we have a meeting scheduled, and hopefully we will be successful in that. There was also a brief discussion about maybe Community Preservation Act in the future, which many of the towns that surround us have.
It's really coming into this area, you know.
And so it might be something we at least want to consider and assess and see if it makes sense for Pepperell and what the benefits are and all that. So we definitely have to gather knowledge about it. I know that we've had some discussions about a year ago. We really got into some detail about this, and And we tabled it at the time, but certainly it's an ongoing consideration because communities and towns, and, you know, they're having a lot of success with the town itself putting away small amounts of money for preservation.
I was urged by the chairman of the Littleton Historical Commission, who by interesting coincidence, John Leibowitz used to be chairman of this commission years ago, that is one of the single most important tools. He said, Ron, if you're going to push for anything in Pepperell, you ought to push for that. Because I was talking about demolition delay and some other things. He said, no, that's the one you got to push for is the community.
Preservation.
Yeah. It's a good deal. And it's one of those things, if people really know more about, they're in favor of. It just makes it makes a lot of sense. And that's why it's being adopted by, 200 towns or 150. It's like almost about half the towns in the state, I think, have adapted it now, or more than half. And there's no reason why we shouldn't.
And I think the guidelines may have loosened up a little bit, but they certainly are, you know, minimal guidelines that the towns have to follow, minimum percentage. But when you look at it on the big, in the big picture, a little bit of money put away, committed to historical preservation,
That's right.
We get a lot done with a little bit from the townspeople. But, you know, it is something that we need to look at the big picture, the value that it brings, and whether or not it's something that's right. So we're going to get some more information and see where we should go. Do you have anything else, Corey, since you have been working on the Colonel Prescott Statue Initiative, and any new developments or...
No, other than the appointment we made, nothing new has come. I know I addressed before that I sent my cousin out to get me some information, but nothing new has come up. I'm assuming he's busy with his own matters, but he might get back to me. Let's keep everybody updated.
Keep us posted. All right. Next is town genealogy, and for that, I will just refer to Francine's email this evening. And she is currently at the Family History Library in Salt Lake doing research this week. And she says that she has a lot to share about Pepperell residents. So she is
uncovering some shocking secrets about your, maybe about some of your Lawrence ancestors.
Yeah. So we're chomping at the bit, Francine, on what she's found out. She says that she's also secured some behind-the-scenes access to NARA, Waltham, as a volunteer. And I do believe that that's the National Archives Records Administration.
That's right.
Well, so she's just alluding to this, so she's keeping us on the edge, and we'll find out more.
Next time.
Yeah, she'll probably send some things out in an email, but right now she's off-site. And she's going to need some assistance in getting something posted on the website, so we'll need some help from IT here, and I'll look into that. And then she also was doing some work on the next agenda item, which is the Blake Mills Dam web reference. And what that is once the mill was taken down, we uncovered artifacts and information and old invoices from the mill and just a wealth of information that we wanted to share with the public. And what we've decided to do, if we can put this all together, is to put it on the town website as a reference with historical information about the mill and how it impacted Pepperell. And you know, they've got some old images and some different artifacts. I'm not sure what she's uncovered, because this was the goal that Francine had, was to get everybody together, find out what it is they have, look at how to put it in some organized fashion, some chronological order, and figure out how to present that to the public. So that's what she's working on right now, and she's got a lot of information put together, but it's still, you know, in the beginning, information gathering stage. So she is working on that and says that she has a good amount of it pulled together already. So we'll hear about that probably at the next meeting if she can make that.
Yeah, I think the email said she doesn't travel again until May.
So we'll probably have our next meeting, one more meeting before that, but we'll see if we can work around when she's back. She is a busy lady, doing a lot of stuff for the commission too right now, so. And that's all that we had on our agenda right now. Is there anything that we need to talk about we didn't plan on, unexpected?
Get through the winter.
Well, that's for sure. It's been pretty mild though.
Yeah, it
is. Can't complain. Well, tonight, who knows what's happening out there right now.
Rain.
So if we don't have any other items right now, we could go ahead and schedule our next meeting for about 2 months hence.
Yeah.
Skip a month and go to the next.
We should
do
2 months. So, well, it's January, very much.
Yeah,
early April, first week in April, maybe.
First week, we usually have the first. We keep waiting the second because a lot of us go to the society meetings. So
right.
First or.
We can do the first.
Third Monday.
Yeah. Seems like the first Monday is open. Unless that's a holiday or some other.
It would be April 3rd.
It should work, unless there's some other.
I'm available.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain I have no plans to be anywhere.
No classes for me.
April 3rd?
Not at the moment.
All right, so why don't we schedule Monday, April 3rd, and we'll see if...
7 o'clock, Town Hall.
Yep.
I'll try and get this
same
room
time,
again.
Same place, same batch.
Is there a reason why we meet at 7?
Would you rather be earlier or later?
I would rather meet at like 6. I don't know how that would fit in anybody else's schedule, though.
For me, it's a little bit difficult. I have to wait to get someone there, you know, babysitter.
All right,
and that
all right.
Tends to be harder to do at 6 than it is at 7. And for a few months, anyways.
All
well,
right,
we could
all
do
right.
It later in the year.
We'll look at it again. It's just I run into my own issues too. Going
okay.
On. I don't want to really.
If you need a babysitter, my wife is. She can take care of you.
Unless I can find a new baby.
Well, the other thing is, if we want to compromise later on, like at 6:30 or something like that,
we could move it a little.
Yeah, we could play around.
Yeah, we'll just keep it at 7 for now, and you know, get into spring and summer. And
it means a lot less than it used to when I was working.
Right, right.
6 when I was working would have been a problem because that means I probably have to get out of work early because I wouldn't get home until just before 6, and I wouldn't have time to eat.
Right, and I could definitely do some.
But now,
it's
a lot easier. Yeah,
so we can maybe be flexible and move around a little.
This shouldn't be as big of a problem.
But you sure? 7?
Yeah.
Okay,
and then we can, we'll look at it the next meeting.
Yeah.
Then we'll be into
so
early spring. Right?
Every time we set a new thing.
All right. April 3rd.
Okay.
7 o'clock. Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, the time is...